Mr. Jones.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Director Ray, for your time today. You've been very patient with all of us. Before I go further, I do want to encourage you to allow your staff to receive an education in critical race theory. I know that certain members of this committee could certainly benefit from that kind of educational experience. Unsurprisingly, I want to ask you about what happened on January 6th. A sitting member of Congress recently described that assault as a, quote, normal tourist visit, if you can imagine that. Would you describe what happened at the Capitol on January 6th as a, quote, normal tourist visit? Just yes or no?
That's not the way I would describe it.
Okay, thank you. The insurrectionists were seen with handcuffs, zip ties, explosive devices, bear spray, and tactical gear. Director, yes or no, would you bring those weapons on a tourist visit to the Capitol?
No.
Okay, thank you. The January 6th attack on the Capitol was planned out in the open, and it was incited by the former president of the United States. Make no mistake about that. But the danger did not end on January 6th. As many of my colleagues today have discussed, the threat of domestic terrorism by white supremacists, anti-government forces, and militias is at an all-time high. With that in mind, Director, I want to ask you whether several troubling recent incidents raise red flags in your mind about these threats. For example, Michael Flynn, the former National Security Advisor, said at a rally, quote, "I want to know why what happened in Myanmar can't happen here. No reason it shouldn't happen here." Does that suggestion of a military coup raise a red flag to you, Director? Simple yes or no.
With respect, I just don't think it's appropriate for me as FBI Director to be weighing in on other people's public comments. It's not that I'm not sympathetic to the reason you're asking the question, but in my role, I think I have to be careful to speak through our work. And when the FBI Director speaks, I speak through our investigations and our intelligence products. And so I don't think I should be starting to start chiming in on other people's public chatter or rhetoric, no matter what it is.
Well, Director, I mean, it's true that you have an obligation to protect the American public, right? And to the extent you can help the American public to understand what kind of dangerous rhetoric poses a threat to the safety and security of the American people, you can do so as a public service. I mean, it's pretty simple, right? I mean, this guy is calling for a military coup. Is that something that would not be of concern to you in your capacity as the FBI Director?
Certainly a military coup would be of great concern to me if I thought it was
Thank you, Director.
Happen.
Or consider this. Prominent officials within one party, I'll just say the Republican Party, have attended events and spoken alongside white nationalists, instigators of the insurrection on January 6th, and leaders of domestic terrorist groups. When leaders of one of our major political parties in this country attend extremist events, does their attendance lend legitimacy to those extremists who are seeking to bring other folks into the fold and convert people to their ideologies? Yes or no?
Again, I'm not trying to be difficult here, but it's just with respect, I don't think it's my role or the appropriate role for any FBI director to be weighing in on other people's First Amendment activity. What I think we need to do at the FBI is to act through our work, to aggressively investigate domestic violent extremism, to aggressively investigate election influence or interference, to aggressively investigate the things that we are entrusted with investigating to protect the American people and uphold the Constitution.
Let me ask you this.
Not that I'm not unsympathetic to why you're asking the question, but
I understand.
Don't think that's my role.
I suspect the answer is yes, if you were to be forthcoming about that. How about this? A former attorney to President Trump falsely stated, quote, "It should be that he can simply be reinstated." And I think you've heard other of my colleagues say this today. Biden, to finish this quote, is told to move out of the White House and President Trump should be moved back in. Could statements like that encourage attacks of the kind that we saw on January 6th, yes or no?
Same answer.
Wow. Director Ray, I've asked you these questions because the insurrectionists threatened more than our lives. They threatened our democracy, and the fact is they still do. I hope that you see that. Those who incited the assault with their calls to stop the steal now threaten to incite another one with their calls to stage a coup or to, quote, reinstate Donald Trump. The violent, far-right nationalism that caused the insurrection is still with us, stoked by elected officials and even the former disgraced, defeated president of the United States, Donald J. Trump. And the American people, sir, need to know that the FBI is working as hard to protect our democracy as the far right is working to overturn our democracy. Hope that we can have that confidence, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yields back.
Christopher Wray was flat-out lying right there. And the fact is, he is an incompetent director. He was not qualified for this job. I think I'm a huge Trump supporter, but I think it was one of the biggest mistakes of the Trump presidency was putting Christopher Wray in there. And I think he showed it, especially in this, his opening remarks that he made today, how biased he actually is. Because everything that he said, especially about extremist violence, was completely sided to the left. Everything that had to do with any type of group that calls themselves patriots or anything that happened on January 6th was noted and displayed by his language as something that is far extreme with very little, if any, people that were there to be peaceful. And he made it sound as though the left is mostly peaceful with just a few things. Everything that comes out of this guy's mouth is pushed to the left, but it's subtle. So if you've been, a prosecutor or a U.S. attorney, or if you've been in the FBI and you listen to his language, you can literally see this. And I think some of these congressmen and congresswomen actually saw this today, and I think they went after him, but he's not going to bend as far as that goes.
I will tell you that I have spoken directly to FBI agents that are investigating January 6th, issues, and ranging from individuals that were in the Capitol to individuals who were not in the Capitol. One thing that stands out, the most recent conversation I had with an FBI agent here in Salt Lake indicated, he said he's never seen anything like this. They are given a mandate. They are to go out. They have been given the questions they're supposed to be asking. They have been given the way they're supposed to proceed on this case. They don't have individualized authority. It is all coming from Washington, D.C. I've spoken to prosecutors that are prosecuting these cases. And this is not individualized justice. They are lumping everybody into the same category, and they are treating them unlike I've ever seen in a case. The Department of Justice is supposed to address every single case, unless it's a conspiracy case, according to the criminal conduct of that individual. They're not doing that. None of the prosecutors have authority. It's all coming straight from Washington, D.C.
There is so much energy put towards these people, and there's not the same energy put towards Antifa. Why didn't he explain that? Why couldn't he explain that?
Well, I don't think he could explain it because, again, he was making this into more of a political stand. And, he said there were three categories of people on January 6th. He failed to completely mention the people who were literally invited into the Capitol building by the Capitol Police. And the majority of the people that were there did nothing. He made it sound as though if you came on the Capitol grounds, you were an extremist. And that is just not the case. There were some violent people there. There were some people that went into the Capitol that did some very nefarious things. But his the way he categorized these people was absolutely wrong. And the way that the FBI has systematically, as Brett just pointed out there, been told how to investigate January 6th, they've systematically been kept from truly investigating or going after the leftists. And that is so clear because of the way that there's just nothing going down about these individuals on the left. And I'll just say one other thing. In all my time in the FBI, the only white supremacist case that I ever saw, and I was in New York the entire time, was prison-related. There was no white supremacy, massive agenda going on in the United States, and it's not happening now. And it's another example of how they use these things and push them out in the media.
When you think about what Antifa did last summer, the number of federal properties that they destroyed or defaced, and the money that they caused to small businesses, the police officers who they injured, the Secret Service members, they really haven't been held accountable to the same type of behavior that they did all last summer. Why not?
They have not been. I mean, you think about what domestic terrorism is. When you burn down a police station and you take over city blocks, that's domestic terrorism. And they have not been held accountable. I'm ashamed to say that, my my former office, you know, the Department of Justice. I wish I could see courage. I wish I could see U.S. attorneys standing up. You know, it's interesting. I represent an individual who went into the Capitol, was told she could go in, and was actually pointed by a security guard to the direction she should go. And she's being prosecuted. She's being charged with misdemeanors. She has no criminal history. She thought the only other Capitol she's ever been in is a state capitol that's open 24/7. She thought you could walk in. So there's a wide disparity between, you know, who Chris Wray is identifying, and they want to prosecute every single person that was there to send a message. And that's what this is. It's message prosecuting. And that's never an appropriate decision by a prosecutor.